morning. Good morning. Welcome to worship at the Lutheran Church of the Holy Spirit. I am pleased to welcome you all here today to worship. Those of you who are here in the sanctuary floor, those of us who are joining us in the Zoom platform, or who are visiting with us or worshiping with us for the first time, I hope you all find the service meaningful. A couple of announcements regarding the life of the congregation. This Wednesday at noon is our final Wednesday lunch. That will be in the fellowship hall. This week's topic we'll be discussing phrases of the Bible or not. August the 9th at 6:30 is family paint night. Come and paint your own ice cream bowl. The cost is $15 per person, and the sign-up deadline is this coming Wednesday, the 26th. That's in order for us to be able to appropriately order the necessary supplies. Announcements added just this morning are a member of the congregation, Jane Worrell, is hospitalized with a broken hip, which she suffered following a fall. And Chuck Worrell would like the name of his sister lifted up, Karen Mack. She just received a terminal cancer diagnosis. So that's Chuck Worrell's sister, Karen. And also today we acknowledge with joy and celebration the 57th wedding anniversary of Ray and Carol Lee Baker. Carol Lee was in the service at 8:30. That concludes my announcements for this morning. I invite you to stand for the gathering dialogue.
Early in the morning, we gather on the edge of heaven,
finding the gates flung open by the one who welcomes all. Early in the morning, we come to this holy place of worship to be touched by the one who offers us grace and love. Early in the morning, we worship God who adopts us into the family, to be filled by the one who would pour us out in service to the world. Let us gather our hearts and minds for worship. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God.
Let us pray. Faithful God, most merciful Judge, you care for your children with firmness and compassion. By your Spirit, nurture us who live in your kingdom, that we may be rooted in the way of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
A reading from Isaiah. This is what the Lord says, Israel's King and Redeemer, the Lord Almighty. I am the first and I am the last. Apart from me, there is no God. Who then is like me? Let him proclaim it. Let him declare and lay out before me what has happened since I established my ancient people and what is yet to come. Yes, let them foretell what will come. Do not tremble, do not be afraid. Did I not proclaim this and foretell it long ago? You are my witnesses. Is there any God besides me? No. There is no other rock. I know not one. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from Romans. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves, so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by them we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God, and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we may share in his glory. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of one who is subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope, we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they have already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. good news from Matthew, the 13th chapter.
Open our hearts, Lord.
Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat, and then went away. When the wheat sprouted and formed heads, then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, "Sir, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Where then did the weeds come from?" "An enemy did this," he replied. The servants asked him, "Do you want us to go and pull them up?" "No," he answered, "because while you were pulling up the weeds, you may uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. At that time, I will tell the harvesters, first collect the weeds and tie them in bundles to be burned, then gather the wheat and bring it into my barn." Then he left the crowd and went into the house. His disciples came to him and said, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field." He answered, "The one who sowed the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed stands for the people of the kingdom. The weeds are the people of the evil one, and the enemy who sows them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvesters are angels. As the weeds are pulled up and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will weed out of his kingdom everything that causes sin and all who do evil. They will throw them into the blazing furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Whoever has ears, let them hear." This is the good news.
Thanks be to God.
Would you please pray with me? Gracious God, we ask you to open our ears to hear your holy word and understand it more fully. We ask you to continue to nurture us, so that we may grow and show your love in our broken world. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Grace and peace to you from God our Creator and our Lord Jesus Christ. Last week, we heard the parable of the sower and the need to plant seeds in good soil. Today, we hear the parable of the weeds, or perhaps more aptly put, the parable of the wheat and the weeds. These two parables are particularly striking a chord with me this summer. Please indulge me a minute while I share my recent gardening adventures. This spring, I embarked on the project of building raised garden beds, a project which 3 months in is still a work in progress. The land I live on is pretty much solid clay. I've gardened for years, amending the soil, and I've done okay, but vegetables do not grow in heavy clay soil. So this year I decided, for the sake of my back mostly, that I would build these raised beds and make the investment of filling them with good soil, a mix of topsoil, compost, and sand, 10 yards worth of premium soil. I designed the layout, I've cut lumber, and took on the challenge of framing the beds on the sloped yard area of my house because the plants will get more light there. My beloved son has shoveled more wheelbarrows than we can count of this soil into the raised beds. I have grown the vegetable and flower seeds from seed under grow lights since March. It has been a labor of love to build the perfect growing conditions. Things are growing pretty good, and I'm sure I'll get some type of harvest. But guess what? Just like in the parable, the enemy is wreaking havoc on my brand new fresh garden beds. I will save my story of my fight with the bunny and the deers for another day, but I no longer see them as God's cute creatures. It turns out that the weeds love growing conditions of good soil, water, and sun, and they are growing abundantly to my dismay. They are flourishing right alongside my tomatoes, my melons, and my pumpkin vines. I take heart in today's parable. Apparently, such is the way of God's gardening. Jesus says, in God's garden, the wheat and the weeds all grow together. Now, the gardener in me says, wait a minute. Aren't we supposed to attempt to get in there and root out the weeds? And Jesus says quite clearly, no, leave the weeds alone. It is not our job to do the weeding, but God's. God appears to be working on all of us, the wheat and the weeds, together. Now, as in the nature of Jesus's teaching in parables, there is a lot to be gleaned from this story if we dig down a little bit. First off, who are we to say what is a weed and what is a good plant? Some weeds are beautiful, and there are some beautiful flowers that are considered invasive species. What we might see as a weed, God might see as a beautiful part of his creation. Who are we to say what is the weed? Now, Jesus stops us from pulling weeds because of what we do not know. In our human realm, what's good and what's bad is often more similar than we would like to think. And this story's power hinges on our ignorance, on what we do not know about others, and the mistakes that we can make when we think we do know. God whispers to us, stop. You don't truly know the weeds from the wheat. Leave that in my hands. The second thing to ponder, let us remember that Jesus's parable is a metaphor. People are not truly or fully weeds or wheat. We can be weedy in one area and wheat in another, and we as people can be changed. There are weeds growing in some of the best of humanity, and there is good grain growing in some of the worst of humanity. There is good and bad growing in each of our hearts. And Jesus counsels us to leave it to God to weed out the bad within everyone. Friends, God is in the business of transformation. God makes beauty from the ashes time and time again in our lives and throughout all the world. It is not beyond our God to be able to transform weeds into productive good grain. The third part to glean, the field, our world, is not just good and bad. We live in a world that is full of weeds and wheat. Helpful and harmful are mixed all around us and within us. As persons, and as communities, our roots are intermingled. We live in a world of much discord about right and wrong, wheat and weeds, good and bad. We live with great polarity and division in every aspect of our lives. The great divides of nations, racism, politics, faith beliefs, church communities are planted in every field. The solution to the tendency to separate and divide our world is found in this parable. Remember what the landowner said to the servants, "Don't pull up the weeds, for in gathering them, you would pull up the wheat too." In other words, you will do more harm than good. You see, the owner of the field understands that the weeds and the wheat must grow together, since the destruction of one will likely lead to the demise of the other. In the same way, our tendency to split our world into dichotomies, believers, non-believers, sinners, saints, good and bad, is not fruitful. We live in this world together, and this world is, whether it's the planet, our country, our community, or our congregation, we are all growing together in the same field. What happens when we get so invested in pulling up the weeds? When we expend all our energy on weeding out the bad, there is little energy left for planting the good. We might be left with a weed-free field, but it is a barren and empty field with no good plants growing. As Baptist preacher Jim Somerville puts it, maybe this is what Jesus was talking about all along. It is better to have a field of wheat with weeds in it than the field with nothing in it at all. The final reflection to consider: tend to the wheat, not the weeds. Getting back to my garden a minute, I found that as the vegetables are continuing to grow bigger, there simply is not enough room anymore for the weeds to grow. Also, in my older flower beds that I've just continued to keep planting in over the years, the more I plant, the more beauty continues to grow. You truly barely notice any weeds there anymore. So I wonder if this parable might shift our attention away from the futile attempts at weeding, our attempts to rightly interpret what is good or what is evil, and instead if it invites us to focus on the crucial work of planting God's love. Rather than calling us to put on our gardening gloves and pluck out what we believe is questionable faith, theology, understandings of God and the world, questionable politics, we are to be the wheat, to do good, to produce good fruit, to seek justice, even in a field where the weeds abound. What if we put all of our energy into being wheat instead of pulling the weeds? Dietrich Bonhoeffer was a German Lutheran pastor and theologian who lived in a time of great evil. He was the founding leader of the Protestant resistance to the Nazi regime, and he was executed for his involvement in a plot to overthrow Hitler. Even amidst those circumstances, Bonhoeffer said, "There is more grace to be found in becoming wheat than there is in pulling weeds." Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King Jr., and many other great leaders chose not to pull out the weeds, but to nurture the wheat. Friends, ultimately, our presence in the world as Christians is not to seek out and purge sin and evil. God will tend to that. Our purpose as followers of Jesus is to invest our energy in embodying the radical love of God in our everyday living, with our hearts wide open, even in a field with some very questionable plants. The parable of the weeds is our quintessential reminder that we are not called to eradicate darkness. The call has always been for the people of God to shine light into the darkness. Let us leave the weeding to God And may we turn our hearts and soul to nurturing the wheat that God has abundantly given. For the glory of God, amen.
Confident that God receives our joys and concerns, let us offer our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of creation. You brought forth all creation and called it good. Direct policymakers to protect lands and seas, bring rain to sun-parched fields, and protect areas impacted by natural disasters, especially nearby areas affected by recent flooding. Sower of the good seed, you desire peace among nations and peoples. Guard our neighborhoods from hatred. Watch over police officers and firefighters, and teach us to advocate for those who live in fear. Sower of the good seed, you are gracious and merciful, comforting those who suffer any affliction, especially Andrea, Ben, Tara, Helen, Glenn, Jane, Kate, Mark, Dick, John, Jace, G, Fred, Dorothy, Pastor Sue, Chris Bronson, Val, Fred, Betty, Pete, Bill, Wilma, Jim, Timothy, Scott, Judith, Eldonna, and the Beeler family, and in times of sorrow for the family and friends of Cameron. Sustain your people living with HIV/AIDS, provide shelter for all who are unhoused, and release any who are unjustly imprisoned. Sower of the good seed, you name each of us as your children. Guide our hospitality ministry to welcome all, our education ministry to equip us for faithful living, and our social ministry to enact the gospel in our community. Sower of the good seed, Lord, we ask you to hear and answer the prayers of all that are now spoken out loud and those that remain silently within our hearts. We lift them to you now. Sower of the good seed, you send faithful people to proclaim freedom from bondage and to renew your church. Encourage us by the witness of the faithful so that we live into the same hope. Sower of the good seed,
into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray. In the name of the one who reconciled all creation to himself, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
As children of light who have been adopted into the family of God, greet one another with joy by sharing a sign of God's peace. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Also with you.
Share the peace. Let's be with you. Certainly do acknowledge the wonderful support that you have shown the ministries of Holy Spirit Church. For those wishing to make a financial contribution today, there are offering plates to the entrance of the sanctuary, and also there are options online. For those who are our Zoom audience today, it's also a good opportunity for you to gather your elements as we are about to celebrate the communion part of our service.
Every problem is yours.
Please stand. May God, who knows you best, be with you. Worship the one who is with us at the table as well as in our hunger for hope. Sing songs of wonder to the one who whispers in your soul. Praise the one who surrounds us in every moment. God of dreams and visions, we offer you our gifts this day in gratitude and praise for your angels who come to bring us your blessings. May our offerings be a sign of our commitment to be a blessing to all the peoples of the earth. So with those who have gone into the deserts and found you waiting for them, and for those who journeyed to the center of faithful living, led by your Holy Spirit, we lift our voices to sing your praises. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." The word and meal. God of patience and hope, sower of all good seeds, show those who suffer the incomparable glory of what you have in store for them. When your children's field is interlaced with weeds among the wheat, when the labor pains of creation groan to highest heavens, give us your heart to live in your time and abide in the truth of what we do not yet see. Bless your people that they may know that you are with them and will keep them wherever they go, that they will exclaim that surely you are among them, though they did not know it. Bring all creation into the eternal joy of abiding in an awesome place, your very house, the gate of heaven, where you dwell forever, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, through all ages with power and glory. Amen. Behind us, under us, beside us, over us, you are ever and always with us. God in community, holy and one, we lift our prayer to you, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. All people are called to Christ's table. Come, eat what is good. For those communing in the pew and those communing on our Zoom platform, the body of Christ is given for you. The blood of Christ is shed for you.
Thank you.
Let us pray. We thank you, generous God, for the refreshment we have received at your banquet table. Send us now to spread your generosity into all the world through the one who is our dearest treasure, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Go out and be a blessing in our world. Return no one evil for evil. Weep with those who weep. Be happy with those who rejoice. Feed the hungry and clothe the poor. Seek justice for the oppressed. And the blessings of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit will be yours. Amen.
Share the harvest.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.